Right, and the recording is on. Let's
See you.
see what we have here. I didn't look too much through the game, just enough to have an idea of what you were going for. So you said your idea was to focus on shape as much as you can.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So of course, so far nothing I can say anything about, but the next move is interesting. This move. I'm guessing you were protecting the cutting point.
Yep.
Okay. And that is obviously just fine, but you should know that this honey is actually really big.
Mm-hmm.
As this honey, let's black possibly start building something on the left side. It's hard to resist against as this double honey is possible. And this means your wall's influence gets limited severely.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So usually.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Just say.
Yeah. So I think I just realized. I think I have the exact the situation with honey you described in one of my correspondence games, and I wasn't sure what to do with it. Yeah.
Right.
So yeah.
That is actually why usually. You just want to extend.
Okay.
This kind of the shape move around. On the second line, actually, the wall is always valuable enough that you can just keep extending as long as the opponent wants to.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do this. However, just this one defense actually already fixes this cut. Can you see how?
One second. So, well, so I should not put this stone into the ladder.
No, you should not ladder the stone if you have other options.
Yeah, but wait. I see. Yeah, because even if we go with e5, e6, e7. We still have some liberty. Okay, I see it. Yeah.
So you accidentally said e7, so okay.
for some reason I didn't recognize this with shape here, but I'm pretty sure we discussed it and I think I even used it. Somewhere. Yeah, I see.
Mm-hmm. Right, so you should actually always consider the net before a ladder.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's almost always better. And can you tell me why the net is better than a ladder?
Well,
why do you not want to do this?
Because we have a ladder breaker somewhere, you know.
Actually, yeah, at the moment, the Blackstone is a ladder breaker, but actually, let's change the picture such that there is no ladder breaker.
Mm.
Why would we still not want to do this if we can net?
So, I think that Black wouldn't want to continue the ladder to the top.
Yes, of course.
So I think Black can sacrifice the stones to gain some advantage.
Yeah, like say Black could get a free move here.
Mm-hmm.
So
and it should cost more than this for stones.
Getting these four stones is more valuable, but let's say if you had the ladder, if you were playing the ladder, Black could choose to deviate from it, like now, to go and play the breaker, right?
Yep.
The reason simply is that if you can net, there is no reason to give the opponent a free move somewhere else, right? So that is why you should always consider the net before the ladder. And yeah, this if you read the net in this position, you can probably see that it doesn't work because black cannot hurry.
Yes.
So if you notice this position, because I would say you should read this now. If you notice this position, then you can see that you can fix it by extending. Then you have enough liberties. So yeah, this is the shape move in this kind of war. And should be the first thing you consider. Just extending. Does that all make sense? Good.
All right, yes, okay. And I think I was caught in I think I made a mistake with the continued chasing the stone from d5 to d6 to d7, and then I realized that he managed to surround me. He managed to surround my group at c7. So yeah, I see. Oh, I see now.
Managed to do so in a reading or in the game?
Sorry, what?
Like, did that happen in the game or in your reading?
No. It was in a correspondence game.
Oh, okay.
It was one of my very early correspondence games.
Has that game finished yet?
I'm not sure. Let me.
Sure, because if that game has finished, seven. We could take a look at it.
7 seconds. Or maybe I'm wrong. I couldn't find it right now.
Okay. So let's continue with this. So black chose to do this double one immediately. I'm not sure if it's correct to do it right now, but it can't be too bad. Okay, so I'm curious about this. What was the intention?
I felt that I had the shape on the left side because a potential for two eyes, and so I can extend.
And are you saying you don't have any bad shape?
Yes. In the current situation, yes.
Okay. I want you to consider that this Atari is simply too big. Leaving such a nice Atari to the opponent is almost always a bad idea. So I actually think the biggest move on the board is just to extend. Or if you want to annoy black shape directly, you can Atari and then extend. This is common shape. Threatening the ladder, if you can see that. Because it's threatening this move, right? So black has to fix. And then you, if you really want, you can even Atari here. So just simply, you don't want to let the opponent surround you so easily. So shape is all about liberties and cutting points, and in this case this move ignored the fact that you have a real liberty issue. And if this happens, then the black is so strong it's not even funny. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So, yeah. You should notice that this stone only has two liberties, and the first consideration should be to defend it. And if it seems like that is not useful in any way, basically, if it means you are willing to tenuki from this, you're willing to do something else and give the ponuki, then you can ignore the atari.
Okay.
Otherwise, defend the stone.
Yep.
But I'm sure you can see that in this picture, Black's position is way too good. Or can you?
In order to build some ice, I need to go down or bottom or to the right from you, the.
You don't need to worry about ice. That wall is too strong for that. What you should worry about is that now Black has basically infinite strength in the middle of the board. Because a ponnuk is super powerful shape. You can never actually attack that shape or abuse it in any way. So that means Black will have an advantage in every fight that comes up in this game. That is why you should almost never let the opponent get the ponnuki. Almost. So yeah, just notice you have a liberty issue and extend. Right. Okay, Black approaches, you back off. Sure. And Black takes use of this turn.
Yep. Yep.
Makes sense. That's a weird move. Black shape move locally should be this one. This leaves some really annoying archer. And I guess the best way to deal with it is to kick here. Because now Black has an annoying decision to make. If Black drops down, preventing from White from getting in further, White can cut. Right? And well, White does what with the ladder? I didn't read this. No, White doesn't have the ladder at the moment. But this means this is an issue later on when White does have it. Right? This ladder. So Black is choosing to make bad shape here, so kicking is good. On the other hand, if the ladder works, so let's say there's a white stone there, then Black basically has to choose to play this way. And we can reduce like this, right? We get a big corner, and Black's side is reduced severely. So it's curious that Black chose to make this shape. And really your first instinct from now on should probably be to kick her. Just to expose that weakness. Does that make sense?
Yes, and I think when you when you show the variation where you put stones on c15 and b14, I realized that b14 was a white stone as well. I realized that I get this an anxiety about these three stones that I'm not sure. I'm not sure, like, is there a way to cut them? Should I defend them? Should I protect the cut at B16 to build two tiger mouse? So yeah.
So wait, at which point are you worried about it?
No, it's just general worry, so to speak.
So give me a move you're worried about.
Something like B16.
So here.
Yeah.
Okay. What if you connect? How does Black follow this up?
Yeah, no, in this case it's good, because even if Black follows with C16, I can connect at D15. But I'm worried about some general case that I know that, you know, Tiger Mouse is an amazing defense, right?
If you're worried, you need to have something you're actually worried about. You can't be worried in general, right? So, if you are afraid there is a weakness, I want you to be very clear about what you're worried about. And if you can't see a specific move that you want to defend against, then don't defend. Right.
Yeah. I see. That's a good point. Because I don't follow this principle we discussed before, that okay, if you read and don't see any issues, then don't defend. I'm with this shape, I usually worry that, like, there are so many combinations there that I just wouldn't read them all, right?
Okay.
So here I don't follow this principle that don't be too paranoid about.
So what I want you to know is that in this shape, if white the nook is, Black can play the 3-3 and this stone will live. You cannot prevent it. And what I want you to know is that the most common defense for that is this honey. In this shape, you should know that this move actually defends against the weaknesses in the corner. But yeah, Black doesn't want to lose their points on the side, so they will honor. And now I'm sure you can see an actual problem.
With the white shape.
Yes.
Something like A14.
No. Just B15.
Ah, yes. Okay.
Kill the stone. Like when we are on this second line, always consider this like second line Atari first. Because if you get that Atari, the stone will die.
Yes.
Always.
Yep.
Almost always. There are some funny cases, like if there's a white stone there, then it's less clear because you can drop down. And well, okay, not enough. Black can't play there.
Yeah.
But white still needs another stone there. Like, this is the kind of possible case where second line Atari doesn't kill. Because then we can connect here. But it's so rare. But yeah, that is why you should first consider the second line Atari. And yeah, just fix. And now usually Black wants to fix too. That was a really big tangent. Something good to know. Oh, you got here. Okay. This might be good. Let's see how you follow this up. Black extends. You Atari.
Again, I was trying to fix the shape.
Let's say there's a comment. Right, exactly. That is the point I made in our last review, that is, you would rather be wrong and learn than lose games due to be playing too slow in the future. So, in this position actually, this Atari is of course not too bad, but the issue is that Black and Atari here, as they did, and they get a nice position. I would be really tempted to fight. I would fight either with this move if I want to play very safe, or with this move if I want to expose black sheep problems. The kind of problems this exposes, that if black harness, well, can you notice what problem black has?
Something with the cut around C9.
Right, black has two cuts right next to each other.
Yep.
So what if we take both of them? Atari, 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 extend. Doesn't this feel nice? We get a massive wall very easily. And black actually has to extend. And we can fix. Doesn't this just feel nice?
Yes, yeah, yeah.
So
yeah, and we prevented black from going to the center. Right.
So you shouldn't easily play this passively. I want you to play this move only if you're actually on the defense, when you have to defend. But here, you already played moves to defend, right? So do you really need to defend more? So, yeah, push and cause liberty issues for black. Black basically has to just extend, has to accept they have a liberty issue. And if you want to, you can keep extending. Right. This should be the first thing you consider. Like, always consider the most violent move first. And if it doesn't work, then do something less violent. Right. Does that make sense?
Yep. Very clear.
Right. This may be a bit difficult concept, and it might feel that you might feel afraid to play this move because what if black plays here? I guess this is your worry. And actually, in later position, if you're worried about something like this, just say so we can discuss it. Then, if you see this, you should know this. How many liberties does this group have?
Three.
Okay. How many liberties does this group have?
Two.
Okay. You should immediately get the tingling feeling. Something is wrong here.
Okay.
And you can just start doing stuff like this. And you can get strength. You can even connect. Like if you connect here, you are now pressuring these stones and these stones. That cannot defend both at once. So you didn't do anything weird here. You just abused Black's lack of liberties, giving you a free attack on Black. And if we consider this position, which group is most likely to die? A, B, or C?
Where is the B group? I see. Well, I would go with C, because well, because of liberties and because of, you know, so to speak, flexibility.
I think that is correct. And most importantly, you did not answer B. White is not the one who is in danger here. Black is. Black has two weak groups. White has one. So this should be an advantageous fight for white.
Yep.
Okay. So yeah. And if it seems that this move doesn't really work, then you can consider this move. And if it seems this move doesn't work, only then go back and play this ladder. Okay. And yeah, it's just shape, like, you don't easily want to let black get this very nice shape. Because when you're worried about your shape, you also have to be worried about the opponent's shape. It is just as important.
Yep.
Like in Go, you can never think about your shape before the opponent's shape. No, no, no. You have to think about both players' shapes at once. And then the game is basically who has worse shape. That is what Go usually boils down to. Okay, so because we didn't protect the corner anyway, black gets to annoy it a bit. Black chose a lame way to do it. I would, as black, I would be tempted to actually play here, because liberty issues. And if white descends, black can descend. And now if white plays here, it's Kote. Which is interesting. But yeah, again, black wants to annoy white's liberties. Okay, we defend the corner. I think this is big enough to do. Black extends here. Very interesting. I guess it should be fine. And it does make sense, because if you tenuki, this follow-up is really big. Like blocking white off from the top side. So it makes sense. So you extend. Black tenukis. Okay, your next move will be interesting. Before we see the next move, can you remember what you were thinking here?
Give me five seconds, please.
I can show you the next move. You played this.
Ah, yeah, yeah. So, again, I'm thinking in this shape. I need to build a very nice shape here. Here, the approximate the stone at K4 gives me, you know, an approximate border, right? A point, a brick in the overall wall. So I wanted to, well, build the wall and prevent black from going to the center.
Okay. I feel there's already too much thought there. And that is something I actually...
So I think my reasoning was very simple. I was thinking that, okay, what would be the best move for black when he invades? It would be J6, because it cuts my groups, my left group and my small stone on the right.
So you thought black would want to play this?
Yes. And then I'm not sure what to do, because, you know, it's not a... Yes, but...
White is so strong that white can just cut here. And this should be the first thing you consider. If you were worried about this, do you want to play this ahead a few moves?
You know, I think I... Let me ask it. I think I... I am a little bit... how do I say it?
Yeah, broken focus. I'll get that.
You know, it's the same situation as with the diagonal of diagonal shape of three stones, right? I feel like there is just too much options that I refrain from
black basically has only two moves here, A and B.
Yeah.
So those are the ones you should consider. Which one would you play as black?
G5.
Okay, G5. Then
yeah, because
white
I
cuts.
Want to go into the center. Yeah.
Then what does black do?
I would go to the center, so maybe something like H7.
H7? Like this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then white kills the stone.
Yeah.
If this happens, then white should feel extremely happy. Because now white actually has a lot of territory on the bottom side. And black has a weak group. So, this actually why you usually don't want to run with the knight's move. Because it is so easy to just cut. And black cannot deal with it nicely. So, the usual running move for black would be the jump.
Okay.
So, this is only important because you said you were worried about J6. And now, white playing J6 is not a bad move at all. It's actually really good. Your intention with this move should be to make it painful for black to live. Now, let's see. What is the best move for black? Maybe this attachment. To try to live. And you have to honor. And back and fall back. You have to fix. Seems black can find life quite easily. Something like this. Not that one. Like there. This should live. Quite easily. So you already have to accept that black will live if you play this way. Or no. Actually in general you have to accept black will live. But yeah. Just something to keep in mind. Okay, so your intention was to keep black shield in, right? What was this move then?
To threaten the H5.
If black plays H5, what did you gain?
So it's he doesn't grow, you know, in this case, he lose a move, an opportunity to grow forward. So it's like in the, you know, H7. Because in case of H7, my sector lines are starting to, you know, to crumble.
Okay, let's imagine you play this move, which is more in line with your original intention. How would you imagine this continues?
J5.
J5, okay. The plug. Don't think too hard about it, just how my Discord crashed, very nice.
About,
sorry about that, my Discord crashed.
J4. So,
yeah, sorry, my Discord crashed, so I think I missed a minute of what you said.
Okay. So, well, I would like to, as a black here, I would like to grow deeper into the white territory. So I'm thinking about G6.
G6, okay.
Yes, but I'm worried about white's move at J4. Because...
J4, that is something to be worried about, actually. As white, I would be tempted to just fix my outside shape.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Remember, shape is above intention. So, if you have broken shape, then you should fix it. In any case, what I want you to notice is if this happens, black is completely sealed in. And now black has to find life here. And that is not easy. And even if black finds life here, white is actually controlling the board and having influence. Like, to most of the board, really. This will help so much everywhere. And say, black does something clever here and finds life somehow. It's really hard to actually find life here. Let's say black does. You play passively and it happens, okay? This wall is actually super useful if you just start building her. Right? But yeah, notice it's really hard to imagine black leaves there. So, yeah. Your intention was to seal black in. So I want you to keep with that intention. When you play here, and if black responds, it's actually getting more difficult to effectively seal black in. Because black doesn't have that liberty issue now. What? Okay. So yeah, just do what you set out to do directly. And don't give the opponent this chance to change their mind. Because now you give the black the chance to go from below. Well, if you do this, and black wants to go below, black has liberties to with two stones. Right? So yeah, this should be like your thought processor. Just keep doing what you set out to do. This move is fascinating. Why this move?
Well, because seems like black takes the bottom part. First of all, I wanted to make some sort of strong shape, right? And to protect this cut, and also I push down the black.
Okay, what is important is that this move does not push black down. Black can just extend here, right?
Yeah.
And black is out.
Yeah.
So your intention was to surround black, so do that. Surround black. And it doesn't matter if you have a shape weakness, if the opponent is literally about to die. So black does not have time to cut here now. Now, if black falls back, then the weakness is real and you can go back and fix it. But doesn't this picture already look much better for white than this picture?
Yep.
So that is why this move is so weird to me. Because you wanted to surround black, and this move does not do it. So shape is above intention, but here the shape move is to surround, not to make a random tiger's mouth. Tiger mouth is a shape for making eyes, right? It is not a shape for attacking usually.
I see.
It's a defensive move usually.
Yes.
The attacking move here is to surround.
Or
to cut, but I like the surround more. Can you tell me why I like the surround more than the cut?
And the alternative is to cut at J3, right?
Yeah, so let's imagine you cut here.
If I go there,
it is very simple. I actually don't think you can guess what I'm going for. So I'll answer. If you play on the outside and do this, these two stones you're getting are useful even if back leaves. These stones can never lose their value. While if you play here and it happens that you misplay and this one stone dies, then you played a move that didn't end up having value. So that is why I like the surround more here. It is easier to play correctly. So yeah. Now, when you're in a similar situation and your intent is surround, I want you to surround. And yeah, remember, the opponent can't use your shape weakness if they also have a big shape weakness. Because right now, like, this Atari is brutal. If black extends, you can just, I don't know, extend. Black is falling to pieces. Okay. Does all that make sense?
You know, I feel like the idea of playing the stones, the idea of playing of playing the stones so they would be useful even the opponent leaves, it's, you know, I feel like I just realized that I don't understand why it is not a contradiction to the idea of single purpose moves.
So let's go back to your intention, which was to surround black. And why do you surround? What is the what do you gain from surrounding? Now remember, surrounding is a technique, not a goal. So what is the goal when you surround?
Oh, to reduce the opponent's territory?
No. Black is reducing white's territory here. The goal when you want to surround is to gain influence for fights later on in the game. So when you do this, you should never be thinking about actually killing black. Because if neither player makes a massive mistake, stones will not die. Or rather, groups will not die. So you are not You should not be killing her. You should be thinking that, hey, I force Black to live in here and I gain influence that I can then use to fight stronger later on. So then, if you try to play some kind of inside move and the opponent lives, then this inside move really didn't do much else than try to kill and fail. So it lost its value.
Right.
In this case, this is actually valid. Like, you can play this way. You still gain something. But just the general concept. So, of course, you should consider this move. Just more often than not, it is simpler to play on the outside. So, does that now make sense why it is not the dual purpose move?
Yeah, yeah, totally. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Yeah, good. Okay, let's continue then. Oh, Black was so afraid. Okay, this is actually really bad for Black because Black was like, Black should just play here, like, get out, and you no longer have an attack. Black chose to fall inside, and you got to keep surrounding them. Which is actually quite nice for White. That said, if this happens, White would rather actually have this move. Reason is, when this happens now, and you turn here, then play Black harness, you can harness back. And again, you can seal Black in.
Yeah, I see.
When you have this trumpet shape, you cannot answer this move with the Hane. Because Black can just Atari.
Yes.
So, this is another reason why the LFI move is actually really bad if you want to surround Black. Right. Okay, this move isn't actually bad, but can you guess what move I would actually recommend here?
So I have two moves in mind. It's either Hane or continuing the wall.
And let's first discuss the Hane. Why would I not recommend this move?
I'm not sure about this one because the the right black stone is too close. I can't read it, right? I could. I'm not sure what
they're doing,
but I just feel that black stone.
Which move?
Black stone is too close. And,
okay, let's start with this. Which move should you read?
N3.
Okay, so let's put that stone there. Then, how could White respond to this?
O3.
Okay, O3. Then, Black has to extend, right?
Yes.
Okay. And what does White do now?
N5.
Oh. Okay. What does Black do now?
So the Black can go to the left, so probably to the right at O4.
Sure. Are you starting to see why this is bad for White? The white stones on the bottom side died.
Yeah, because we can't honey at P4. P3 is not looking good as well. So
yeah, if we play P3, like extend, kill. Very simple. So And even if you don't notice this move, you can say, hey, black an Atari and connect. Remember, second line Atari kills.
Yep.
So you should consider this move very quickly. So now, in this position, you know there is only one move you have to consider. It is the cut. And then it immediately gets difficult to find good moves for white. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm sure you can read, like, let's say this far, and notice that this will probably go wrong.
Yeah.
Mm. And if you can't, then practice. Because you have to be able to read four moves.
No. So I had this exact situation that, okay, I think that maybe I should cut, but then there is some, but then he will cut me, and then there is black stone at the right, so it doesn't look good.
Mm.
So yeah. It's just, you know, reading this couple of moves for both sides, and then this gut feeling that, okay, no, something is not right.
Right. I would say that at your level, you can make, like, no decision should require more than four moves of reading. So your move, opponent's move, your move, opponent's move. If you can read that much, that is more than enough for your level. And even just two moves is good, or three moves. If you can do four, that is enough for most decisions. If you try to read further than that, it get every move gets more likely to be wrong, right? Because you're not very strong yet, so if you read deeper, the more likely it gets that the moves you are considering are just wrong, and the reading isn't helpful. Right. So, what is the other move that you could consider?
Just continue the wall at N3.
Yeah, just do this. And why?
Oh, well, because if the idea was to surround, right? So it's the best move. So the black needs to respond at N2, right? And then this conversation continues.
It is the same shape as on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
It is big for black to get this move in.
Yep.
So this kind of hane from second to third line is usually something you want to prevent. Just do that. Like, playing that move in this shape, like when the opponent can hane to the third line, it is very rarely wrong to just extend. It's really big. What about O2? Do you mean this? You can use voice too, by the way, it's fine. This move is suspicious. What about this?
Yeah, that doesn't turn out quite how I thought it did. Because I was thinking you just cut it there, but then you end up in the same situation with two stones under that die.
That could also play here.
That's not as bad, right?
Becomes the same thing.
It's still bad. Okay, my bad.
Or that can also just push. And if you try to fight, well, you fall to pieces still. Just doesn't work. And again, to notice this doesn't work, you don't need to read more than like two moves. And like when there's this kind of situation where the cuts are the problems, then You can basically like consider these three moves. Read each of them out like 2 to 3 moves. See what happens. Mm-hmm. If any one of them is a problem, then you shouldn't play this move. Sure. But okay, like, I cannot say this is a bad move, because it's not. But I will say that leaving and my Discord crashed. Very nice. I hate Discord so much. Okay. I don't know why it crashes so often on my PC. Yeah, so I was about to say that I cannot say that this move is a mistake. I would just say that in this shape that we have on the bottom side and mm-hmm. that we had on the left side, mm-hmm. I want this extension to be your first instinct.
Mm-hmm.
And these third line stones will always be more valuable than those second line stones.
Mm-hmm.
Because the second line stones are only making 1 point each. And it is very difficult to only make 1 point with third line stones. Now, about this move. I can't say it's bad, but at this point it feels like the bottom side is already very uninteresting. Black can't build anything more there, white can't build anything more there. So I would want to either, let's say, connect my groups. That is usually very big.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope you can see why this is big. Can you?
Well, it strengthens the sector line, helps white to go to the center, prevents black to go to the center.
Mm. So, too much thought. If black connects, yeah. It is now difficult for white to connect these groups, which means white doesn't really have influence here. White has two groups, and neither of these two groups is actually quite alive.
Mm-hmm.
So white doesn't have as much influence as it seems. So if we connect the groups, then neither of them can ever get under attack.
Mm-hmm.
So it is influence. Do you know what influence is?
In my mind, it's some sort of probable territory.
No. Probable territory is Moyo.
Ah, okay.
Influence is strong group, like strong stone, strong meaning they are fully alive. They cannot be attacked. Strong group that projects strength to the rest of the board. Meaning, I can put an example here. Say we get to a fight, say there's a black stone and we play here black pincers.
Mm-hmm.
We get to a fight.
Mm-hmm.
This influence means our stone has somewhere to run to.
Mm-hmm.
This means no stone we have on the board needs to live. Because we can always run to our strong group.
Mm-hmm.
It also means that if we get to a fight, we might get to use this influence as a wall we can ram the opponent to kill them. Does that make sense? Because if in the game it happens that we force black to run, and okay, it's hard to make this work without getting some extra moves, so let's say we have this and we attack and we force black to run this way, right?
Mm-hmm.
We can, I'm playing bad moves with the intention to set up this example. see how we can ram plug to our influence.
Mm-hmm.
And that influence works like a wall or like an edge of the board.
Mm-hmm.
But one that does not give liberties or eyes to plug.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So in every fight, this influence means the decisions become harder for black. As we can run to that wall, meaning it is difficult to attack us, and if we can force black to run towards the wall, it becomes really difficult for black to live.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Well, yes, but I will definitely watch the video several times to get back to this concept, right?
Yeah, don't worry about it. Influence is maybe the most difficult concept in Go to understand. And your first answer, that it's potential territory, is the common pitfall. Because you should not be trying to make territory with this group. It is so difficult to make points in the center. No. The way this influence becomes points is that it lets you do absolutely insane fights, absolutely insane invasions. Because you always have that safety net. That is where the points come from influence. So, this influence, it is not potential territory. It is strength you have in every fight that will come. And actually, I want you to make that mental adjustment or try to, that in your game, if you are thinking, I have influence, now I will play a move that makes points from it, then try to refrain from making that move. Because
usually
it is wrong.
Yeah, okay.
You were saying?
By probable territory, I don't mean that, I have to, make points right now, right? I meant that it's like a force or a potential support, right? But not a territory not a probable territory that I have to make the real territory right now.
Okay. I would say that if we have a position like this, now you could call it probable territory.
Yeah, I see now.
Because even now you need more moves to make it territory. But now it's starting to look like there's some kind of framework that could turn to points. But it's still not points. This is the point where you could say that it is probable territory. Now it's a moyo. That is what the moyo is. At this point, it is only influence. So, do you now understand why I think this is a big move?
At age 7?
Yeah.
It's a little bit more clear when you explained the influence with the metaphor of running
right
to and from.
The influence thing, but also the fact that there is no chance you actually become a weak group. Because remember, weak group is negative points. Weak group means your opponent gets to attack and make points from you. So it is that too. It becomes influence, and it means you will never become, or you will never get a weak group here. So it has like double value. Another big area that I believe is bigger than this would be to play something on the top right corner. Can you tell me why? I alluded it quickly earlier. Why do I think this is bigger than approaching the bottom right corner?
Well, because it lays the foundation for more influence than the bottom right corner. Because bottom right corner, you have white group, you have black group, you have this small corner. But in the top right, black have a potential to just grab, grow from it. Very fast, right? So,
important thing to note is that top right corner can grow to the top side and to the right side, while the bottom right corner can only grow to the right side. And if black gets a stone here, you can still reduce this right side, right? While if the black stone comes here, you can reduce one of these sides. Black can still build on the other side.
Yep.
So this is why I believe the top right corner is bigger than the bottom right corner at the moment. Because that is where black can develop the most. And if an area is the biggest area for one of the players, that means it is the biggest area for both players.
Mm-hmm.
Because you should always consider this. The points you remove from the opponent are basically points you gain.
Mm-hmm.
And black can build the most on top right corner, so that is the most interesting area. Another interesting area would be to somehow reduce the left side. But I would say that is the least interesting area. Can you tell me why?
Well, it's still there. There is just less space to, you know, to work with.
Right, so the area is so secure, like let's say everything below this line is territory. So every move, like any move either player plays there, like somewhere in this area, will have smaller effect in the score than playing basically anywhere else. Now, there is one move that you could consider there later on. That is this move. Can you tell me why? Why is this move interesting to me?
Well, it prevents black from going to the center.
Right, so which move would black play to grow the left side?
To
be like, which move would black play to build the left side?
I think the one you.
Yeah, like this is the most natural move.
Yes, because it's like the closer to the center, and it also pushes the white group. The white groups down, preventing them from going.
Right. So this limits black's potential severely. It also actually starts slowly making a way over white. Right? And it gives white more influence. Like if I were.
In what way? In what way? You said that this move helps helps White to start building the Moria, and would you mind explaining in what way?
So remember the moves I showed, like if he imagined White is building a Moria, they would be like something like this, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
Now this move is one of the moves that is kind of defining the Moyo.
Right? So it's like a pillar.
Right, like it's like one of the edges. So
okay.
Again, this is not the Moyo yet, but after this move exists, there can be a dream of building a Moyo. Does that make sense? So this move is like affecting the potential of both players. And that is why this is an interesting area to play in. But still, at this point, I believe top right corner is the most interesting area. And after that, maybe. After that, maybe this. But it's always difficult to say. And again, I want to emphasize, it is impossible to say that this is a bad move. Because I don't want to say that approaching a corner is ever bad. Okay. Why this move?
I think I was following the idea of surrounding the black group.
Does this surround it? Remember, what is the intention or what is the goal with surrounding?
Well, the goal of surrounding is to get an influence in the later parts of the game, right. And it definitely
and
does.
This move is giving us influence to this area.
Yes.
So, if you want to surround, the move is here. Surround the entire group, not at once though. Because there is no joy from trying to surround the F2 stone if the entire rest of the group breaks out. That should make sense. So I would say this move is basically a pass. If you had at least played something like this or this, you would gain endgame in the corner. This would have more value than F2 or F3. So I'm sorry to say this, but I really hope I never see a move like this from you again. Because like this move is something that even if you have a great game going, playing a move like this can instantly end it, because it's almost a pass.
Right. Okay. Let me meditate a little bit on it. Right. So, at this point of the game, what are my worries here? Right. So I'm worried that Black will move at something like F4, right?
So if this move isn't here, you are worried about this.
Yeah. I'm trying to understand. So.
So again, you have to remember, you can always connect your groups, and if you are connected, you are not in trouble. Because if you consider this connected group. You have at least this eye, and probably here, right? This can not become not eyes. So do you then need to be worried about Black playing a move to remove an eye?
You know what? I think so. I'm trying to remember. You know what? I was we discussed, I think, when we discussed my previous game, we discussed that groups about ice rather than territory.
Mm-hmm.
And I think here I was still thinking in terms of territory.
Even if you think in terms of territory,
mm-hmm.
how many points is this move making?
A couple. Like F4, F5, right?
We wishful thinking. That can still, like, just remove them. So you haven't made those points yet.
Yeah.
I would be happy to say that this move makes half of this point.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can still remove that point too. And how many points does it remove from black?
One second. One at G3.
Okay, maybe, but black didn't have a point there even before. And actually, something to consider.
Mm-hmm.
Does this shape look familiar to you?
Yes.
So, if you want to play a move here, this should be your first instinct.
Yes. I know. When I was thinking about potential moves from black, I realized that I didn't play to the
right
three. I think you know what I was. I think I didn't recognize it because I was my pattern recognition software didn't work because there is also the J3 group,
mm-hmm.
and for some reason I recognize the H4 stone as a part of this small group, right? G3 and H4, rather than this diagonal elephant jump, because I had the exact same situation a couple of other games where I realized that okay, there is an elephant jump, but I didn't recognize this pattern before.
But here, even if you recognize this, playing G3 is too small. Like, I can just ignore it. But especially when you play this, then I can still ignore, but I can also like play here and what F3 is doing is extremely unclear to me. So, I hope you can see why this move is so bad.
In addition to the loss of influence,
you didn't lose anything, like.
To the lack of influence, right?
Well, not even lack. Like, the point is mostly that this move isn't doing anything. It's not attacking black. Like, that group is alive. Like, very easy. Like, black can always connect here. Like, connect the corner. That group is never going to die. This F3 stone is doing very little in terms of territory. It's not gaining influence. So what is it actually doing if it's not doing any of those things?
Well, I have a very simple answer, right? I was thinking about the shape, this shape method.
Sure. I understand that you were thinking about the shape, but while shape is above intention, you still need to have an intention for making a shape.
right.
So making a shape is not the goal. You need to have a goal that shape achieves. I want you to add that to your logic. And again, like, instead of making a shape, you're just like connecting It's a shape move on its own.
Mm-hmm.
Shape is about fixing your issues. Fixing cutting points, fixing liberty issues. So this is a shape move too. Even though mm-hmm. this is not a shape you can find mm-hmm. in a shape lecture video, right?
Mm-hmm.
So shape is a much broader concept than what this move makes it seem like.
Mm-hmm.
But so yeah, I'm I understand why you made this move. I'm just hoping that now you understand why you shouldn't do it again.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are not going to make this move, what else could we do on this board?
Well, the moves we... So, first of all, we need to understand, can we just leave things be in the
mm-hmm.
in the bottom left?
That is a very good question. Can we?
So, I was thinking, I'm more worried about the F5 now.
F5.
Mm-hmm. Right, because it's I feel like it directly threatens this group on the left.
Yep. Give me a follow up. Or actually,
mm-hmm.
okay, yeah, let's do this first. Give me a follow up.
Mm-hmm. One second.
Mm-hmm.
So, what's all good?
Sorry, I didn't hear.
Oh, sorry. The most obvious is F6.
F6. Okay. What text?
Right. Yeah, but still, I will be able to make two eyes. This at E. E8 and at D5.
Yeah, you should be able to. You might get under attack like black and start to fight. So it's a bit painful.
It's the second. It's the second thought that I have that.
This is scary.
So,
this is a bit scary. But notice what happened here. This position is a bit scary. But mm-hmm. black got two moves. Mm-hmm. So what if we don't give black two moves? What if he respond to this move?
Mm-hmm.
How would you respond as white?
Oh, to F6.
To F5.
My response is to play stone at F6.
Ah, right here. Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah, and now if you see this picture, does it seem scary?
Oh, no, wait, no, because even if black plays at H7, I can go with J5, right?
Chief. You can do something like that, but if you just want to keep your dot simple, you can just kill those stones.
Yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Or you can wait. What? You can start connecting. You can do a lot of things, right?
Uh-huh.
It is so hard to imagine an attack after you see these two moves.
Mm-hmm.
And notice again, you only had to read two moves.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Right.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
So during the game, I believe you didn't actually read this.
Mm-hmm.
You just thought that F5 is scary, but you didn't consider how the board looks if you respond to it. Am I correct?
I think so. I think so.
Okay. So then, now that that is underway, your question was that are you worried about anything in the bottom area?
I worried about this group in the bottom area. So if no, we don't. So it's a free move for me, right?
Sure. So what moves could you consider? Or maybe let's do this first. Which area is the most interesting?
Well, I think it will be cheating, right, from my side. But we already discussed the areas of the...
But notice that the board has changed since then. There are extra stones on the board, so the answer might be different. Mm. So use your own judgment.
Okay. So, I'm not sure how did the move at F2.
Don't consider specific moves. Just consider which area of the board is the most interesting.
Give me a few seconds.
I just want you to look at the board and tell me where a stone can have the biggest impact on the game. This is very important for like your general decision-making progress or process, during a game, which is that before you start looking for specific moves to make, you should consider where on the board that move should be in. Because if you try to look at the entire board, especially in Byo-Yomi, there are just way too many options to consider. So you want to limit the area.
Well,
Byo-Yomi clock is running. 10, 9, 8,
I think
6,
we should go with the
5,
top left.
Okay, top left.
Top left, because so I was...
I think you mean top right.
No. I mean top left, because the... Sorry. I mean the area around, H13. Because my reason was because I looked at my group at G17 and well, you see, my group at F9 it still has a chance to to go to the center, right? To push the left side of the opponent. To push the opponent to the left side, but my group at J17, I am starting to worry about it because it's like, it's behind the wall, a small wall, not constructed yet, but still a wall of black.
But you do realize that it's on the third line, so it can just make eyes very easily.
No, yes. I mean that black is building this connection between top left and top right.
Hey, sorry. I need to grab some water, so just give me a couple of minutes.
Yeah, sure.
There we go.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so you were saying something.
Right, so to worry about the situation at the top, because I don't have a strong presence there.
So wait, what are you worried about? Are you worried about Black getting too much influence, or are you worried about dying?
I'm worried about Black getting too much influence, but by going to the point one, right, and pushing me to the top.
Okay. Right. So, if you're worried about that, then which moves could you consider?
What we discussed, G11, or something to do with, I don't know, H16.
I like H16 a lot. That's a very nice move.
Because it's not connected, so he connects, and then I have this. Yes, I have this. You know, potential line of A1B, right? So,
right. Well, the important thing with this is that it is actually causing a lot of liberty issues for these stones. Meaning, later on, this push and cut can become brutal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right.
Something you should consider always, these cuts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes, remember, shape is all about cuts. Mm. Mm-hmm. So maybe Black responds to alleviate that issue. And you can probably push again, because Black doesn't want you to wrap around. Right?
Right.
So maybe Black extends.
Right.
And hey, we are suddenly building the top side on a large scale.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I actually really like H16. That is a very nice move.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're worried about the left side, I would not mind this move either.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
I believe these two moves are the best options if you are worried about the left side.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, we identified what is the most important area on the board in your picture. What is the second most important area?
Top right.
Okay. What is the third most important area?
Bottom right.
Bottom right. Okay, so something there. What is the fourth most important area?
One second. Probably around N8, or maybe, you know, maybe
so,
or 10 around this area.
So you're saying the middle?
Yes, yes.
Okay, I would say the right side.
The right side, okay. Mm-hmm.
Sides before center.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, do you realize what just happened? In the span of
please continue.
In the span of about 1 minute, you created a game plan.
Mm-hmm.
And like you create a game plan, you realized, okay, first I want to deal with the left side. Then I want to approach or invade the top right corner. Then I want to settle the bottom right corner somehow. And then I want to do something about the right side.
Mm-hmm.
You just created a game plan. And now you can start looking for moves based on this plan. Does that make sense? Like, that is a process you can use in your games to figure out what to do and when. And notice, you have these numbers, then you can say, okay, this B move. This B move is actually interesting when we compare, when we think about the top right. So we can play here and we do something interesting and we can approach and maybe black backs off. We do something fun. And then we're okay, yeah, this team settled. So we go to the last corner, right? We created a plan by designing which areas of the board are important and like in which order. And then just do it. And at each step, like, you don't even need to make that order. You can decide, okay, well, now I've decided with the, now I have dealt with the left side. So what is interesting now? And I think now you would again decide on top right corner. So just decide the interesting area and then start looking for a move there. And this way you have to consider way fewer moves.
Yeah, you know, so I try to do that. But you know, I always get distracted because that's this move. Now I need to worry about my shape, or do I need to worry about my shape? Right.
This requires practice. It's very easy to get distracted.
Yes.
What I recommend doing is before Pyoyomi. Like, say, when you have 3 or 5 minutes in the clock, then do this evaluation of the board. Decide which areas are interesting and which order. What do you need to do to win the game? Try to form a plan like that before Pyoyomi. And then, when you are in Pyoyomi, you do not have time to think about this.
Yes.
Like now it took you a couple of minutes to do this, right? So, and in the game it's maybe a bit harder even. So just start doing that. And I'm sure it will help a lot. Because then at the least, during Pyoyomi, you will not be as lost in what you should be doing.
Wait, so on... before Pyoyomi, I should regularly regulate the plan, right? Not just build it, but regulate.
I would say it's enough if once before you enter Pyoyomi, you do this. Because before Pyoyomi, you have enough time to do this actively. But before Pyoyomi, just... And the plan doesn't need to be anything more than which areas are important in which order. That is a plan. You can't plan more accurately than that because you can never know what happens in during a game. But you can at least decide like which areas you care about. Yeah, so...
I care about...
And if you make that plan, then even in this board, I'm sure you would not have ended up with this move.
Okay.
Like now, I'm sure this move feels quite ridiculous to you.
Yeah.
That is good.
Sadly, yes.
wait, when does a turn like F10 become a good move? These turns are usually when they matter with liberties, right? The reason is simply that this move actually gives black nicer options than the gamer. Maybe black wants to play this way. This is sometimes possible. Then you are never going to get this move because black can push. Instead, if you play the game directly and black wants this still, you can push here. So, if there is no liberty consideration, the game is usually better. Now, if there is a liberty consideration, like maybe black gets in some trouble here, like with these cuts, then the F10 push is better. But that isn't the case right now.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. What?
So how about break until tomorrow?
Break until tomorrow. You want to end now?
Yeah, I mean, we're going for 2 hours.
I think actually right now we have discussed about everything that is interesting about this game.
Okay.
This was the last thing. So good timing.
Okay, great. Yeah, I mean, I think it's like, you know, the best topic to end the video, right? It's very, it's great.
Right. I actually didn't realize we took that long, but I again hope...
I just realized it myself.
Yeah, I again hope that the review was useful, and I hope it didn't get boring. Cool, I'll end the recording here.